Could we have a look now at the seat of Kildare, held by Sandy McKenzie in the last parliament? They've counted 61% of the vote. That's very close to what is needed for a safe prediction. The ALP led by 6% with 43% counted last time, and Mr. McKenzie got back in, but this time, with 60% counted, he has a deficit at the moment of 7%. That's going to be extraordinarily hard to make up. And it looks as though, despite what Mr. Nixon said about holding them all, that Kildare could be a National Party casualty.
We'll go to Diamond Valley now in Victoria, marginal Liberal seat. And here we have one of the, a minister who appears to be one of the casualties of the 1983 election, the Minister for Communications, Mr. Neil Brown, who first won this seat in 1969. He lost it in 1972 and regained it in 1975, holding it ever since. But it has been very much a seat that goes according to the government of the day. If we have a look at the figures now, with 75.7% of the vote counted, the swing to the Labor Party. Mr. Brown has made up some ground in more recent counting, but the swing to the Labor Party is good enough to win them the seat. It's a 3.7% on a two-party preferred basis. But the key to that
is going to be the Democrat preferences. And if the Democrat preferences run higher than 55%, then that's going to make Mr. Brown's job that much harder.
And I think they will, Victor, particularly in this seat, because that is where the Tasmanian Wilderness Society launched its campaign. And it's a very high Democrat vote. And I think that you'd have to allow for a certain percentage of no-dammers sort of going towards the Labor Party in that.
Casey, another seat in Victoria, situated close to Diamond Valley, and they've counted 82% of the vote. They're not final figures yet. Mr. Steedman, who was very active in student politics in the 1960s, probably at the same time that Mr. Faulkner was at Monash, in fact has a very handy lead of nearly 2,000 votes. This is a pretty even area, and certainly the Liberals last time led all night. The fact that they have a deficit now of over 2,000 votes suggests that they have no chance of holding the seat of Casey.
We go to Flinders now in Victoria. We were commenting on this seat before our friends in the West joined us. The significant thing about Flinders, it's one of six seats that appear to have gone to the Labor Party in Victoria. The other five were seats that the Labor Party held during the Whitlam years, between 1972 and 1975. Flinders is the exception. So from that regard, I guess it represents probably the Labor Party's best result on the night. You'll remember even in the West that even though the Flinders is remote from you, that it gained some notoriety late last year as the battleground for a by-election. The Labor Party failed to win the seat on that occasion, but they're assured of victory this time.
Seat of Bendigo, the seat based on that provincial city, held by Mr. Boucher. He took it against the tide in 1972. He defeated Mr. Kennedy, who many people thought was all set to become education minister in the first Whitlam government. Mr. Kennedy, of course, is now in the Victorian Parliament as the local member for Bendigo. They've now counted 82% of the vote. Those are final figures. Mr. Boucher is trailing by 4,000 votes. He has the postal votes to make them up, and I believe that's an impossible task. I'm confident that the government whip, Mr. Boucher, has been defeated on this occasion.
No, he's now industrial relations.
The seat of Chisholm is another seat in Victoria.
Yes, Chisholm, the candidate here for the Labor Party is Helen Meyer, who was given a difficult job in 1977. She was the Labor candidate who stood against Mr. Peacock in the blue ribbon seat of Kooyong. She was given a better chance in 1980 when she was pre-selected as the candidate for Chisholm. She lost it on that occasion, but managed to make considerable ground against Graham Harris, a barrister and a Liberal company director who succeeded Tony Staley in 1980. Now, in these figures, she's managed to overtake Mr. Harris. The swing in her favour is something like 5.5%. I think, well, with 85% of the vote counted and their final figures, then we can say that Helen and Mayer are certainly on the way to Canberra.
Well, just as Chisholm has never been held by the Labor Party before tonight, so Deakin, another seat in Victoria, created in the eastern part of the city of Melbourne, has never been held by Labour since it was created in 1937. It's been held by Mr. Jarman since 1966. He now has a deficit of over 5,000 votes with 86% counted. And therefore, John Saunderson is going to be the next member for Deakin. The swing to Labour has been in the order of about 6% on a two-party preferred basis, so that Deakin is not one of those that was in the first 11.
We go to Queensland now, and Bowman. Results have been coming in a little slower, of course, in Queensland, with the polls closed there because of daylight saving an hour later than they did in Victoria and New South Wales. But this is one of the Queensland seats that we've given over to the Labor Party. With 54.5% of the vote counted, it appears that Lynn Keogh, who held the seat from 1969 to 1975, will be returning to Canberra.
We look now at the seat of Herbert, held by Arthur Dean since 1977. Based on Townsville, the Liberals' most marginal seat in Queensland, they've now counted over three quarters of the vote. In fact, the count in Queensland has gone very fast. And the lead at the moment is held by Mr. Lindsay. He has a majority of about 2,000 over the combined votes of the Liberal and National Party candidates, because Mr. Dean has been assisted on this occasion by the National Party to try and hold this seat. Well, they have intervened, and I'm sure their preferences will flow very strongly if they get a chance to count them. But at the moment, Ted Lindsay, who contested the seat in 77 and 80, he's a solicitor, 40 years old, he has an absolute majority. It would be remarkable if he didn't hold that majority, or at least win the seat on preferences. So this is another victory for the Labour Party.
Now Petrie in Queensland, and we find another minister who has almost certainly lost his seat, John Hodges, who's the Minister for Immigration and Ethnic Affairs. And it appears that he has lost his seat to the Labour challenger, Dean Wells, a university lecturer who you might recall wrote the book The Wit of Whitlam. He recorded a 6-point...
I'm afraid I'm going to have to interrupt, Barry, because at this stage it looks as though the Prime Minister, Mr. Fraser, may be making an announcement from the Southern Cross Hotel in Melbourne.
Mr. Fraser's aides are pushing their way through the reporters in the crowd to get him to the VIP room here at the Southern Cross.
Well, I'm afraid Mr. Fraser made a rather brief appearance there. He had said that he wouldn't be appearing at all this evening until he was ready to make a statement. So, of course, we were interested at that stage to hear if he was going to make a statement there. But as you saw, he arrived and disappeared inside rather quickly. So we haven't got anything to bring you from the Prime Minister, Mr. Fraser. Of course, as soon as he does decide to make a statement, we'll be bringing it to you from our outside broadcast unit at the Southern Cross Hotel in Melbourne. We're keeping a very close eye on what's happening there, but just for the time being, until Mr. Fraser does make an announcement, back to Barry and Victor.
Let's look at... Have you finished with Petrie, Barry?
Yes, I have.
Could we have a look at the seat of Leichhardt, please? This most northerly seat in Queensland, held by David Thompson. It's been an ALP seat, actually, for 24 of the 34 years it has existed. They've now counted a third of the vote. I don't believe that is enough to decide the result here. It seems to me that Leichhardt is still in doubt. This is such a varied seat. While you had an even pattern of voting in the last election, in the sense that the early figures reflected the final result, that may well have been a fluke of the way in which the figures came in. And therefore, I wouldn't guarantee it's going to happen on every election. And I'm quite certain that Mr. Thompson will not be prepared to concede when, in fact, there are only the two of them. He is trailing by 1,000 votes at the present time. And I'm sure that he will still hope that he might make this up. The National Party won't concede this. And while the Labour Party might be very hopeful, they'll have to wait until more votes are counted.
We go to Kingston now in South Australia. Virtually the... seem to have lost a light on another set. We go to Kingston in South Australia, virtually the only seat in South Australia where there was where the parties centred the crux of their campaigns. It was held by Grant Chapman for the Liberal Party, with 84% of the vote counted, and these are final figures. We can see that Gordon Bilney has won this seat for the Labor Party. Gordon Bilney is a public servant and a former diplomat. In fact, he was High Commissioner to Jamaica, and as such lived in Kingston. Rather ironic that he now becomes the member for Kingston. But I guess Grant Chapman was always up against it. Gordon Bilney needed a swing of only 0.2%, and the donkey vote in this seat normally runs at about 0.5%. And of course, with Bilney having the edge over Chapman, he had to, in fact, achieve a swing in his favour to hold the seat. That's how difficult a task he faced. We can give some figures for the National Party as a whole across the country. The swing against the National Party in New South Wales has been 3% in the primary vote, 2% in Victoria. They have improved their vote by 1% in Queensland, and their vote has declined by 1% in South Australia, but that I don't think is very significant. They were not, of course, contesting in Tasmania or the ACT. The message seems to be that the National Party has suffered less damage in this election than its coalition partner. Can I have a look at the preference rank for the National Party, please? Yes, the only seats in which the Labour Party is leading are Calair and Leichhardt. And we've already looked at both those seats. It is still very close. They obviously have a much better chance in Calair at the moment than they have in Leichhardt. So it looks as though the National Party losses in this election might in fact be limited to two seats. Dawson, however, is very close, and since we haven't had a look at Dawson, perhaps we should have a look at Dawson on this occasion. The seat of Dawson, located on the coast in the vicinity of Mackay. The figures show 62% counted. Mr. Braithwaite, who held this seat, was certainly very much in the firing line. This was considered one of the seats that Labour was very hopeful of picking up. At the moment, he just has not quite got an absolute majority. He has 49% of the vote, nearly 50. He has a lead of about 500 on his Labour Party rival. There is no Australian Democrat vote here to be divided up, and therefore whatever share of the Democrat preferences Mrs. Hill was going to get, she was in fact going to get directly, not through preferences. The Progressive Party should help Mr. Braithwaite very considerably, even though they've only polled 200 votes. In a matter as tight as this, those are going to be very helpful. So Dawson is one we'll have to watch.
Well, Victor, as the evening is progressing, of course, we get a better idea of what's happening in the voting in the Senate. Dennis Grant has been concentrating particularly on the Senate vote. Dennis, what have we got at the moment?
Well, at the moment, we've got something of a technological nightmare because our computer, which is looking after the Senate, has broken down. And what I'm restricted to is watching binoculars, every man's kit for the Black Opal Stakes in Canberra tomorrow. But look, what I can tell you is that the results, the vote figures are coming in very, very slowly. Down in Tasmania, which is the most interesting, you'll recall, Richard, that I said that if Senator Harradine could keep up his vote figure that he scored last time round, then he would be taking a running mate with him to Canberra. Now, what's happened in the early part of the vote in Tasmania, in the Senate tonight, is that Senator Harradine surged ahead. At one stage, he was over the 2-quota mark. Now, that was when they had counted roughly 2% of the vote. We've got some more figures in now. They're up to about 23%, and Senator Harradine's rate of climb has been arrested somewhat. He's not going nearly as well as he was. But basically, the figures are very, very slow. And of course, we know from past year's experience that sometimes it can be up to a week before we've got a definite result in the Senate. But in Queensland, on figures just in now, the National Party looks to be up, the Liberal vote down, and the Labour vote up in Queensland as well. So it's somewhat confused, I'm bound to say. Early results, and we really haven't got much of a sample yet to be very specific on. I think it'll be a great deal later in the night, Richard, before we get anything quite definitive from the Senate.
Right, well, thanks very much, Dan. Of course, see you, Dennis, as we do hear anything very definite from the Senate or any more from the Senate, then Dennis Grant will be keeping us in touch. I think I should mention that our computer has been doing extremely well this evening, as you've probably noticed and appreciated. Here in Canberra tonight, it's a very hot evening, and especially here in the tally room with quite so many people, Of course, it's very difficult for the computers to function on top line. They've been doing very well indeed, but unfortunately, with the Senate, as Dennis said, we do have some problems with the computer look at the Senate. Right now, though, we're going to cross back to our panel of political figures, and Peter Couchman is the chairperson over there. Over to you, Peter.
Thank you, Richard. Well, Colin Mason has been checking with his scrutineers, and I'm rather interested in the way your preferences are running.
The advice I've got, Peter, is, and this seems to me a fairly decisive fact, is that Democrat preferences in all places are running roughly 60% to Labour and 40% to Liberal.
Now,
in other words,
they're more or
less gone with the swing, I would have thought.
So that they'll be favouring the Labour Party?
They will tend to favour the Labour Party.
By 60-40?
60-40, of that order.
Now, what do you make of that, Steele, given the couple of seats that are balancing on Democrat preferences at the moment?
Well, if that's the case, it will be a great help for the Labour Party, of course, in getting a couple more seats, the ones that you mentioned that are in balance. My scrutineers in Boothby down there are saying that they're going about 50-50, but of course that's not a seat in question. My majority is only down half, well, less than 0.5%. But I would have thought that with the Hawke charismatic challenge, as it's called, that he would have taken some of the Labour supporters out of the Democrat vote and left a bigger harvest for the Liberals. Now, Colin, putting it as he has from his scrutineers, is disproving that theory, but that was a theory I had. And I'd like to see a greater in-depth study of the preferences before I give it away.
Yes, of course, it's still very rough at this stage. But, for instance, where you've got, for instance, in Diamond Valley, where Neil Brown is really holding on by a thread at the moment, a 60% preference leakage to the Labour Party could be decisive, would it not?
Of course.
What about your vote in the Senate at the moment, Colin Mason? The Democrats are doing significantly better there than in the House of Reps,
I know. Yes, very much so. It looks to me as if Senator Chipp is home. Very little doubt about that. He's something like 1.5 quotas now. Senator Haynes in South Australia is back with something like the same sort of situation, quite comfortably in, and they will be long-term senators, of course. It looks as if Norm Sanders in Tasmania, about 3/4 of a quota, will get back. My own position is about 0.86 of a quota, and I have hopes that that will develop during the evening and that we may well get back with those. Senator Macklin's position in Queensland is yet unclear.
Right. Well, look, Bob Brown from the Wilderness Society is still watching the count from our Melbourne studio, so we'll cross down to Melbourne and see what Dr. Brown is making of the vote at this point in the evening.
I think it's been a tremendous victory for Australia as a whole, as far as its environment's concerned, not only for the Franklin River, but for our other World Heritage areas. And I look forward to seeing the Franklin River running free and safe for many years to come. There is a lot of adjustment to be made for Tasmania, but I think ultimately it's saving our economy too. It's saving us wasting hundreds of millions of dollars on a dam we don't need and can't afford.
Has your part of the campaign been as successful as you'd hoped?
Yes, it's in every seat where we've taken an active campaign, the result has been tremendous. We've had scrutineers in the seat of Phillip, for instance, in Sydney, who tell us that 14% of the Labor vote has been along the lines of the Wilderness Society and Conservation Organisation's preference guidance rather than that of the Labor Party itself. In Bennelong, I believe Milo Dunphy, the conservation candidate, is polling at 13%. And the seats where we've campaigned hardest, Bendigo, Calair, Petrie, these seats are showing the effect of the Wilderness Society and Australian Conservation Foundation's campaign and the concern that Australians had that they didn't want to see the Franklin River destroyed in the manner put forward by the Hydroelectric Commission in Tasmania.
Dr. Bob Brown, who's the head of the Tasmanian Wilderness Society, talking in our Melbourne studios with Bram Alexander. Now, as you'll remember, just a very short time ago, the Prime Minister, Mr. Fraser, made an appearance in Melbourne at the Southern Cross Hotel. We thought he was going to make a statement, but unfortunately that was not the case. But whenever Mr. Fraser or Mr. Hawke decides to make an appearance before the press this evening and make a statement on how they read the results of today's election, of course, we'll be bringing it to you as soon as it occurs. We'll interrupt whatever's happening to hear all of what Mr. Hawke or Mr. Fraser have to say. But now I look at more results as they're occurring here in the National Tally Room in Canberra. Back to Barry and Victor.
Well, we now have some results for Western Australia. I think we should look at those straight away. Let's go to the seat of Stirling. This seat held by Mr. Viner, minister in the outgoing government. He held it with a majority of 2.1% at the last election. They have now counted 2.5% of the vote. The swing is to the Labour Party of about 8%. The disappointing thing, I suppose, from the Liberals' point of view, although they obviously are going to want a lot more votes before they start worrying about Stirling, is that they led all night in 1980. And here, already, with the first packet of votes, Mr. Ian Viner is trailing. Given what's happened in Western Australia earlier and what's been happening across the rest of the country tonight, then that sort of sign is not very encouraging. Fremantle is one of the... Well, Moore, would you like to have a look at Moore?
Yes, I'll have a look at Moore. We haven't got any figures yet for Perth, but on our early figures we have the Labor Party leading in both Moore and Stirling in Western Australia. Moore is held for the Liberal Party by John Hyde, who's another farmer who won his seat for the Liberals in 1974, and he's known as one of the leaders of the Dries. With 5% of the vote counted, that's now a better share than we had a moment ago, and we see that the ALP candidate, Alan Blanchard, a public servant who stood in 1975 unsuccessfully and 1980 unsuccessfully, is doing very well. That's that, even though it's their early figures, they must be very encouraging for Mr. Blanchard.
Now to the seat of Fremantle, held by Mr. John Dawkins since 1977. He originally held the seat of Tangy in 74. He lost in 75 with in the Liberals' big victory. He was re-elected in 1977 for the seat of Fremantle. It's on the south coast of the Swan River. They've only counted 2% of the vote. However, there is a swing in primary votes to the Labour Party of about 7%. Mr. Dawkins, if he continues that sort of march, will in fact increase his majority in comfortably holding this seat. And the seat of Swan.
We have some figures for Swan, have we? Yes, we have. Well, these are very early figures. Only 0.6% of the vote has been counted. So for as much as you can trust these early figures, the swing to Mr. Beazley for the ALP on primary votes is something like 14%, and on a two-party preferred basis, something like 12%.
Well, I see that we have new figures in now for... we have the Labour Party, I should say, leading in 18 seats. However, two of those seats are Moore and Stirling, where I don't think the results they're not sufficiently well advanced in the counting for us to trust them. The seats are, to repeat, Phillip, Eden Monaro, MacArthur, Barton and Calair in New South Wales, Diamond Valley, Casey, Flinders, Bendigo, Deakin and Chisholm in Victoria, Bowman, Herbert, Petrie and Leichhardt in Queensland, and Kingston in South Australia. Labour has made no progress at all in Tasmania and failed to win the most marginal of the Liberal seats, the seat of Wilmot.
Perhaps it might be worthwhile having a quick look at New South Wales. There are still a couple of seats there that we felt were too close to pick. Perhaps Barton, it might be worth... Barton is not one of those seats we've already...
Calair was...
Calair is a close one, a National Party seat. Held by Sandy McKenzie for the National Party. The swing to the Labour Party on these figures is 5.5% on a two-party preferred basis. So, Victor, I guess on those figures, the Labour Party must be looking in pretty good shape.
Yes, I think they are. I have grave doubts that Mr. McKenzie can hold that for the National Party. We said before we think it's going to be a casualty. The only difficulty is that they haven't put any votes in since before 11 o'clock, so that... Perhaps the next lot of votes that they do put in will make a big difference. And MacArthur, which we looked at before, that's a seat that we believe that the Labour Party has won. They've been after it for some time, held by Michael Bohm, situated on the situated south of Sydney. And we still don't have final figures, and those are very late figures. They were put in at 23 minutes past 11. And at the moment, Labour has a majority of primary votes of 3,000. That's not quite half the votes counted, but it's 49.8%. And therefore, if preferences are needed, it seems very likely that the 60% of the preferences, which Senator Mason says is flowing to the Labour Party, will be enough to elect the Labour Party candidate. I should say that in the computer, we guessed that the Democrat preferences would run 55-45. That means, of course, that we are understating, if Senator Mason's figures are correct, we are understating the flow of Democrat preferences to the Labour Party, and therefore the Labour Party is consistently in a better position than we make out in these marginal seats.
Probably the seat most similar to McArthur would be Eden Monaro, in the sense that it's a country seat that the Labour Party was hoping to pick up and seems to be doing so. Well, these last figures were fed into the computer at 10:51. They show 59% of the vote counted, and the sitting Liberal, Murray Sainsbury, seems to have lost that seat to Mr. Jim Snow for the Labour Party. The swing to the Labour Party is 5.4% on these figures.
Could we have a look at the latest in Western Australia to see if there are any new figures for seats we haven't so far considered? We now have some figures for Tangi and Forrest and Canning, so we could look at those three. First of all, the seat of Tangi. That's held by Peter Shack, the Liberal Party. It was held fairly comfortably and was described in some reports as a fairly safe Liberal seat. With 3% of the vote counted, it's looking far from safe with a 10% swing to the Labour Party, but I'm quite sure that we will have to wait very much longer to decide what the outcome is in this particular case. The seat of Canning.
Canning is again a seat held by the Liberal Party by a farmer, in fact the farmer Mel Bungie, who won the seat in 1974. His ALP opponent this time is Wendy Fadner, research assistant. With 2% of the vote counted, and it's probably not an accurate guide, but the early figures favour Mr. Bungie, despite the national trend and despite what appears to be the trend in Western Australia. There has been a swing away from the Labour Party on a two-party preferred basis of 1.8%.
We look now at the seat of Forrest, which is in the extreme southwest corner of the continent, a rural seat held by Peter Drummond. He was elected in 1972, farmer, 51 years old. They counted 3% of the vote. And while there is a 7% swing to the Labour Party on these early figures, that would not be enough to dislodge him. We can expect that the late vote in this area will in fact favour the sitting member, and so Mr. Drummond does not look like being one of the casualties in the West as far as the Labour Party is concerned.
I notice, Victor, on our latest figures now we have the ALP leading in 20 seats, so there have been two additions since we last read those out to you, but they're of course West Australian seats and the figures are too early.
Right, well one of the seats that has come on is the Northern Territory, and therefore we should have a look at that seat. In the Northern Territory last time, the sitting member, Grant Tambling, led all night. At the present time, with 18% of the vote counted, he is in fact about 200 votes behind the ALP candidate, Mr. Reeves, a solicitor from Alice Springs. That is not necessarily conclusive. It seems to me that in the Northern Territory you need a lot of the votes counted before you're prepared to predict the result. But certainly it is encouraging. I was in Darwin 2 weeks ago, and it seemed to me in the sampling I did amongst people that I met that most of them thought that Mr. Tambling would get back, and most of them thought that was that would happen, because it seemed that the recession in Australia had hit the Northern Territory and especially Darwin much less hard than it hit the rest of Australia. And they may still, of course, be right, but the early figures are, in fact, favouring the Labour Party.
And Bob Hawke, indeed, didn't go to the Northern Territory during this campaign. Victor, obviously, it means a lot of travel, but the Labour Party leaders have campaigned in Darwin in the past, but this time it wasn't on the agenda.
It seems to me that perhaps we should have a look now at the seats that are likely to be held by women representatives in this in the new parliament. First of all, the sitting members, Henty in New South Wales. I suspect we haven't looked at that before tonight.
Can you find your list?
The seat of Henty is held by Mrs. Child. She won it first in 74 and then lost it in 75, won it back last time against Mr. Aldred. They've now counted 81% of the vote. They haven't posted final figures yet. And in fact, Mrs. Child has improved her her position, and she has a two-party preferred vote of 5%. The seat of Lilly in Queensland, that is held by Mrs. Elaine Darling. She won the seat last time from Kevin Cairns, a Liberal. I know that the Liberals and the National Party really had no hope of winning that seat back for Mrs. Darling, who has been a most energetic local member. She has in fact improved her primary vote by 9%, and it is our understanding that she will improve her two-party preferred position by about 8%. It looks as though the margin she will be defending in the next election is in the order of 9%. The seat of Canberra, which is held by Mrs. Ross Kelly. That was one of the first seats we showed you. There was a big swing on then, and it has been maintained. I'm staggered to find that they've only counted half the vote in Canberra, which seems remarkable when they have counted much more of the vote in other areas.
Well, Victor, while we're talking about some of the situation for female contestants in the electoral process, let's cross over to Senator Susan Ryan, who is on a panel with Peter Couchman.
Well, she's not only on the panel, she's on a high at the moment. you've been sort of cheering quietly to yourself as all these women candidates have been polling so strongly. I mean, how many, have you been making a note there, how many new women members of the reps would you expect to see in the new parliament?
I think we'll see four new women. I think we'll see Jeanette McEwen-Phillip. We've already heard that Helen Mayer has won Chisholm. We'll see Wendy Faton in Canning, and we are hopeful of either Barbara Robson in Moreton or Barbara Hill in Dawson, their Queensland figures. And of course, we're very pleased to see that our sitting women members, our three women who won their marginals last time, have scored enormous swings.
Well, Ros Kelly's done extraordinarily well in the ACT, hasn't she?
Yes, well, that's my electorate.
This is quite a remarkable turnaround, isn't it? Because only, what, 5 or 6 years ago, it was considered to be electoral suicide to endorse a woman, wasn't it?
Yes, we've had to fight against that traditional view in the Labor Party, and we have done very successfully in recent years, and I'm just delighted that all of our women candidates are doing so very well, whether they're sitting and increasing their margins or whether they're winning marginals. And I think that the old belief that women candidates are a liability because of their sex has been well and truly trampled to death tonight.
Well, it certainly has with this election. We're standing by the way. Bob Hawke is in the Canberra studios of the ABC, and we're just waiting to get a signal from the studios, and we'll make a cross as soon as we can. Still, it really interested me to look at the endorsed candidates from both the major parties, because the Labor Party endorsed so many more women than the Liberals did. I mean, is this because you're being a little bit more conservative about this and your endorsement procedures?
Well, you can't point the finger, of course, at the party in general. The pre-selections are held for the Liberal Party in each individual seat, and it's a matter of the support that individual candidates have. I think we do need to emphasise the role of women more and get more women into Parliament. I'm certain that's an essential aim for the Liberal Party. But on the other hand, I again restate, it's not some dictatorial move we can make from the top. It has to be a grassroots movement from the women themselves.
Yes, well, it's certainly an interesting vote that the women have carried tonight. But things are moving ahead in Canberra studios now, I gather. So, Richard, we'll go back to you.
Thanks very much, Peter. Well, as Peter just mentioned just a moment ago, we have heard that Mr. Bob Hawke has decided to make an announcement, and he's chosen the ABC television studios here in Canberra to make that announcement, to hold a news conference. We'll be crossing to those studios just as soon as Mr. Hawke decides to begin his conference. That's not the case at the moment, but I gather he's either there or on his way. So as soon as he does get there and is ready to make an announcement, we'll be bringing it to you. The same, of course, applies to Mr. Fraser. He's in Melbourne at the Southern Cross Hotel, and we have an outside broadcast unit standing by with Mr. Fraser. And as soon as he decides to make an announcement, we'll bring you that as well. But for now, it's back to results. Barry and Victor.
Well, since we were talking about women candidates and you were discussing which parties had endorsed lots of them, it should credit should be given to the Social Workers' Party, which endorsed 18 out of 38 candidates were women. Now looking at the women who had been re-elected to Parliament, let's look at some of those mentioned by Senator Ryan as those who may win seats and enter Parliament. First of all, Mrs. Jeanette McHugh, who is contesting Phillip. We have a look at the seat of Phillip and see how Mrs. McHugh is doing. Phillip is one of the inner suburban seats of Sydney, held by Jack Burney. They've counted 65% of the vote. The two-party preferred swing to the Labour Party is only 2%. That is less than has generally been occurring, but it is looking very good for Mrs. McHugh, and of course it would be even better if Senator Mason is correct, that 60% of the Democrat preferences are flowing in that direction. In the seat of Denison, Cathy Smith was contesting it for the Labour Party. She'd contested it, she had not contested it before. But Michael Hodgman, in fact, has increased his majority. Mrs. Smith's problem was that she was contesting a seat in Tasmania, and that was bad news for the Labour Party in this election. And while apparently Dr. Bob Brown is confident that Bob Hawke can stop the dam, it, I'm sure, is going to provide lawyers with a very interesting time as he proceeds to put that policy into action.
Victor, we're just at a stage at the moment where I hear at the present time that Mr. Hawke may be entering our Canberra studios at any time. The information that's being passed on to me at the moment is that they're literally expecting him to walk in through the door of the press room. This is our Canberra ABC studios. At the moment, we're just standing by, waiting for Mr. Bob Hawke to make an appearance and an announcement, as he's been promising to do through the evening. Doesn't look as though he's there just yet. Another false alarm, but that's just to show that we are extremely keen to bring you an announcement either from Mr. Hawke or Mr. Fraser, indeed both, as soon as that announcement occurs. So we'll be doing that as soon as it happens. Until then, of course, we'll be bringing you all the latest in results. So back to you, Victor. Sorry to interrupt.
In the seat of Chisholm, Helen Mayer is contesting the seat and we believe has won it for the Labour Party. They have now posted final figures in Chisholm, a seat never before held by the Labour Party. And with 85% of the vote counted, the swing on a two-party preferred basis has been 5% to the Labour Party. The Liberal candidate is trailing by 4,000 votes, and there is no way that that can be made up. Now to have a look at one of the women contesting a seat on behalf of the Liberals. The woman with the best chance of being elected was Anne Dunkley in the seat of Isaacs, but it does not appear that she has won this seat. There has in fact been, with final figures posted and 85% of the vote counted, a swing on a two-party preferred basis of nearly 7% to the Labour Party. And so Mr. Charles, who won this seat last time from Mr. Burns, has not only held it, he's increased his majority, and it will be much harder next time for the Liberal Party to win this seat back.
Victor, I might just add that if Mrs. McHugh does win Phillip from Jack Burney tonight, she will be the first woman member that New South Wales sent to Canberra in either the House of Representatives or the Senate, so that's quite an achievement for her.
Are there any more seats, any more figures in for Western Australia?
Yes, there are.
Just before we move on, we actually have a profile of Ms. McHugh, who may well be winning the seat of Phillip. So let's go to that profile right now.
Jeanette McHugh, former teacher of modern languages, mother of three, passionate believer in no dams for Tasmania, and a campaigner in the anti-nuclear movement. Once a director and founder of the Bondi Pavilion Theatre, and now involved in theatre in education.
And my first entry into a political party, actually joining a party, was joining the Labour Party because I was so concerned about the Vietnam War, and that concern arose over what was happening to people.
One of her major concerns in her electorate is this childcare centre at Bondi, starved of both federal and state funding, she says. She spends a considerable amount of her time and seemingly inexhaustible energy trying to solve its problems. Her campaign has been conducted with the same energy.
Well, I suppose the first thing is I'm different because I'm a woman. There have been so few women politically campaigning in Australia, but there has never been a woman from New South Wales in the federal parliament.
Jeanette McHugh, who looks as though she will probably be the new Labour member for the seat of Phillip. Well, now more results are still coming in, so back to Barry and Victor.
The position now is that with the Western Australian seats coming in, Labour is leading in 21 seats. And those seats are in New South Wales, Phillip, MacArthur, Eden Monaro, Barton, and Clare. In Victoria, Diamond Valley, Casey, Flinders, Bendigo, Deakin and Chisholm. In Queensland, Petrie, Herbert, Bowman, Leichhardt, and a new seat has come into range, the seat of Sir Jim Killen, Morton. In Western Australia, Canning, Tangy and Perth, although I would stress that those are all on small percentages counted in Western Australia. Kingston in the seat of in the state of South Australia and the Northern Territory. Now, if the Labour Party managed to win all those 21 seats, and we haven't said that they're going to win them all, but if they did win all those 21 seats, they would have a majority of 21 in the new Parliament, and that I'm sure would be considered to be a landslide. Should we look at the seat of Moore first for our Western Australian viewers? This is a seat held by John Hyde. He was elected in 74. He's a farmer. It stretches along the coast from Perth's outskirts northwards up towards Greenhead. They've now counted 20% of the vote. There has been, on our calculation, a 9% swing to the Labour Party. The Labour Party already has a lead on primary votes of 2,300. And the remarkable thing about that figure is, as I've said before, the Liberal candidate in the last election led all night. And therefore, to be trailing by so many votes so early is very bad news for Mr. Hyde.
We might now go to the most marginal seat in Western Australia, Perth, which is held by Ross McLean for the Liberal Party, has held that seat since 1975. With almost 8% of the vote counted in Perth, there has been a swing of 6.2% for the Labour Party. They are early figures, but again, they are reflecting the sort of swing that the Labour Party picked up in the state election in Western Australia. The Labour opponent is Rick Charlesworth, who is a well-known sporting identity. We have a profile on Rick Charlesworth, and we might go to that now.
If the ALP wins Perth, it'll be a big bonus for the Pollies in their annual cricket match against the Press Gallery. The Labour candidate is Dr. Rick Charlesworth, a former captain of the West Australian cricket team and the present captain of the Australian hockey team. Dr. Charlesworth needs a swing of just over 1% to win the seat. This should be easy given his status in the community and the prevalent anti-Fraser feeling in Western Australia. But he has to beat Mr. Ross McLean, who has a strong personal following and is generally regarded as the best of the lower house Liberals from Western Australia. Dr. Charlesworth has been trying to get away from his image as a sportsman. He's been pushing his work in the community as a medical practitioner. He's also been prominent in the anti-smoking campaign. Dr. Charlesworth is 30 and is married with two young children.
Canning and then Morton.
Dr. Rick Charlesworth in the electorate of Perth. Now back to Victor.
Well, let's have a look at the seat of Canning. This seat, which is situated east and south of Perth, includes Armidale, Rockingham, has been held since 1974 by Harold Bungie. They've now counted 4% of the vote. It is very close at the moment. It's almost equally divided between the two major parties, and you would need about 50% of the vote counted. Certainly last time, Mr. Bungie led all the way in this particular seat, but we'll have to wait until much later figures for this.
We might go to Morton now in Queensland, which, as Victor told you before, is now on the list of seats, government-held seats, in which the Labour Party is leading. And Morton is held by Sir James Killen, who first won it in 1955 and has held it ever since. Sir James is Vice President of the Executive Council and a former Defence Minister. Labour's hopeful is Barbara Robson, a housewife and former physical education teacher. In 1980, she gained 7.3% of the vote, setting herself up for an even better swing at it this time. And we see with 79% of the vote counted, the swing to the Labour Party is 4.7%. Now, this is a seat that's going to be in some doubt, I would suggest, into the week. Perhaps part of the swing against Sir James could be explained in the fact that that it's an open secret, of course, that he'll be giving up his seat between now and the next election.
And of course it was in 1961 when everything hinged on whether Jim Killen could win the seat of Morton and keep Mr. Menzies, as he then was, in power, and he did win it then. He could win it again tonight, but it is not going to affect the fortunes of the Liberal Party, because the Labour Party has already won this election. One of the things we might do is to look at the seats of the people who have retired so that they have to be new members, apart from, there are obviously new members where sitting members have been defeated. For Labour, for example, John Armitage held the seat of Chifley for 14 years. 62 years old, he has not contested this election. The new member will be Mr. Gorman, and he has held it with just a slightly increased majority. They've counted 81% of the vote, and that has always been one of the safe seats for the Labour Party, now very safe. Charlie Jones held Newcastle for 25 years. He's retired now at the age of 65 years, and that seat is going to the Labour candidate, Mr. Morris. He is the brother of Peter Morris, who holds the seat of Shortland. And I wondered whether two brothers had ever held seats simultaneously in the Parliament, and the Fraser brothers did it in Eden Monaro and the ACT in the late 1960s, early 1970s. Jim McMahon in Sydney did not secure pre-selection, and so he did not contest the seat of Sydney. That seat will now be won by Peter Baldwin. There has been a small swing of about 2% on a two-party preferred basis to the Labour Party in that seat. Always a safe seat, and of course it includes Norfolk Island, or is it Lord Howe? Lord Howe Island, sorry. Dr. Moss Cass in the seat of Maribyrnong relinquished that seat after holding it for 14 years. He's retired at the age of 56 years from the Parliament. It has been won by Mr. Griffiths, and he has improved the Labour vote by 4.5% on a two-party preferred basis. Somebody else who didn't secure pre-selection was Ted Innes in the seat of Melbourne. So in the seat of Sydney and the seat of Melbourne, there have been changes for the Labour Party. And in the seat of Melbourne, Mr. Falshaw has, I'm so sorry, Mr. Hand has won it for the Labour Party, and there has been a swing to the Labour Party on a two-party preferred basis of 4%. Laurie Wallace retired after 14 years. Most of these people, you see, won their seats in 1969 from Grey in South Australia. He has retired at the age of 59. It had been a difficult seat to hold, but he'd always seemed to manage it. It includes, of course, the Iron Triangle at the head of the South Australian Gulf. And with nearly 80% of the vote counted, there has been an improvement in the Labour vote by about 4%. The Liberal member to retire from this Parliament was Mr. Geoffrey Giles, who held the seat of Wakefield. That's a South Australian rural seat situated in the interior, and it has been held for the Liberal Party by Mr. Andrew, and there has been in fact a swing to the Labour Party of about 4%. And the other seat, of course, is Gippsland, where Peter Nixon, who we saw earlier, held the seat. He retired at a comparatively early age. He's only 54 years old, with 44% of the vote counted.
Victor, if I am sorry
Party
to interrupt.
National Party candidate is winning.
We've just had the opportunity at the moment on the tally room floor behind us to talk with Mr. Paul Keating, who's Labour's spokesman, Labour's shadow treasurer at the moment. He's with David Gee, and he's with us right now.
Mr. Keating, it's government for Labour, but at this stage, by how much?
Well, we're not certain yet until the West Australian results come in, but I think we can see 14 seats certainly, with still the possibility in Eden Monaro, Casey and Petrie. And I think the swing in West Australia is very strong, so if there's five seats there, it makes it a very substantial victory.
Mr. Hawke has then had a crushing win over Mr. Fraser. There's only, one way to describe it.
I think that's how it will appear when the final votes are tallied.
Presumably you will be Treasurer in the Labor government?
I expect to be, yes.
Where will inflation be in, say, 6 months' time under a Labor government?
Well, I expect inflation will decline under a Labor government. We're the only party which has gone to this election with an anti-inflation policy. And I expect that we will make substantial inroads on both unemployment and inflation.
Do you think the Liberals made a mistake by touting the campaign that investors' money would leave the country?
I don't think that scare tactics are a legitimate tactic in any election. Putting money under beds, scaring people about the exchange rate, these things are not legitimate tactics as far as I'm concerned. The Labor Party campaigned on a very positive program of economic recovery with the containment of inflation and the reduction of unemployment. And all we saw from the government was not even, in fact, an articulation of them standing on what is, after all, a very poor record, but rather a very negative campaign against the Labor Party.
There are some disappointing results. Tasmania would be one of them.
Yes, we are disappointed with Tasmania. We thought that while at the beginning of the campaign that we wouldn't win seats in Tasmania, but as the campaign moved on, we thought that the national swing to Labor was reflecting itself in some way in the Tasmanian seats.
Do you put that down to the dams campaign?
I think the dams issue has polarised the Tasmanian community. I think the issue with Tasmania is no matter how much governments think they can band-aid the problem in Tasmania, if the national economy is sick, so is Tasmania. And Tasmanians, I think, are deluding themselves if they think that in some way they can insulate themselves from what is the rest of the Australian economy if the economy is indeed languishing.
How soon does the ALP now put in place the machinery for assuming government?
Well, that'll happen as we elect the cabinet sometime this week.
Thanks very much.
Well, Mr. Paul Keating, who expects to be a treasurer under a Labor government, speaking with David G. I'm just getting a message at the moment that although Mr. Bob Hawke has been keeping us on tenterhooks this evening, we've been expecting him to enter our ABC studios here in Canberra moment by moment, and every now and then it seems as though he's just going to get there and then he's not going to get there and so on. And we had expected by now, since here in Canberra it's now about 2 minutes after 12, that Mr. Hawke would have been in our Canberra studios by this time. Of course, we're also wanting to bring you an interview with the Prime Minister, Mr. Fraser, as soon as possible. But we had expected that Mr. Hawke would be prepared to speak with us first, and it's a little bit later than we expected. I'm just getting a message now that Mr. Hawke is through the front door of the Canberra studios, but he's just heading for the makeup room now. So it's going to be a couple more minutes before we can actually get him in front of the bright lights and have the cameras rolling on Mr. Hawke. But at least we know that he's in our Canberra studios. He's chosen to make his announcement in the ABC studios here in Canberra, and we'll be bringing that to you as soon as we possibly can, but at least he is inside the building. As soon as he's ready, we'll be crossing straight over to the studio, but until then, we'll be having a look at some more results. So back to you, Victor.
We should certainly now have a look at the seat of Fadden. There's been a turnaround there with 56% of the vote counted. That is looking pretty good for the sitting member, Don Cameron, but now with 56% of the vote counted, he is beginning to trail. The Labour Party has 36,000 votes, 36,500 votes. The Liberal candidate, 28,000. If you add the nearly 6,000 that the National Party will deliver, or they'll deliver most of them, then it becomes extremely close. The point is that last time, when there was no National Party candidate, the Liberal led all night, and at no stage did the Labour Party get better than 45%. They are now polling 49% and very nearly have an absolute majority. It seems that the preferences from the Democrats, if they are flowing as strongly in Queensland as they are elsewhere, then Mr. Beddall must have a chance to win this seat. So Fadden is one that will have to be watched. It's not one that normally, well, I suppose Labour would have expected to win that. It only required a swing of 1.5%. But for a time, Mr. Cameron looked to be doing very well. But now it seems that the swing is getting to him, and we will have to keep an eye on that seat.
I wonder if we could go to Stirling now in Western Australia. We have some updated figures in Stirling. It's a seat held by Ian Viner, now the Minister for Defence Supply. And we see now with 22.5% of the vote counted, the swing to the Labor Party on a two-party preferred basis is 4.8%. Now, if that trend was to continue, Mr. Viner would become the third minister to lose his seat in this election. Already, Mr. Hodges, the member for Petrie, the Minister for Immigration, is in great danger of losing his seat, and it certainly seems that Mr. Brown, the Minister for Communications and the member for Diamond Valley, will lose his seat as well. And we have an interesting contest in Moreton in Queensland, in the seat held by Sir James Killen, and the government whip, Mr. Boucher, the member for Bendigo, has also lost his seat.
And of course, one of the other ministers who is having difficulty in holding his seat is Davis Thompson, David Thompson in Leichhardt.
I'm afraid I'll have to interrupt you again, Victor. I've just heard that Mr. Bob Hawke is now into our our Canberra studios. Unfortunately, there he is, yes.
Well, I want to say, first of all, to the people of Australia, thank you for the confidence which they have entrusted in me and my colleagues in forming the next government of Australia. I thank my parliamentary colleagues for the work they've done in this campaign in supporting me. And particularly, I want to thank those who have been close to me in this campaign. I don't name them on this program now, but everyone knows to whom I refer. I and the party are deeply indebted to the work that they have done in assisting us in what I believe has been a positive and now clearly a successful campaign. In saying that, I thank the people of Australia who have put this trust in me and my colleagues. I want also particularly to say that those who have voted another way, that this is going to be a government for all Australians, irrespective of how they cast their vote. And in a sense, may I say, particularly to the people of Tasmania, you have cast your vote somewhat out of kilter with the rest of Australia, and I know that there have been particular issues there that have been of concern to you. I want to give you, the people of Tasmania, right from this moment, my assurance that my government will be particularly concerned with the problems that have been close to your minds as you've cast your vote. My government will honour the promises that we have made in respect to Tasmania. The dam will not go ahead, but as I've said, you are concerned legitimately with issues of adequacy of power supplies and of employment. I have made it clear on behalf of this incoming government that we will meet your concerns in that way. So I say that from this moment, I commit myself, I commit our government to undertaking from this moment the task of national reconciliation. And as I say to all Australians, however they've voted, that we will be governing for them all, I ask you all now to give us your trust, your confidence, and your cooperation. We have a magnificent country. If we all work together, we can see, I believe, no bounds to what we can do. So once again, I thank you all deeply.
Gary Scully, ABC, and congratulations.
Thank you, Gary.
Apart from the economic summit, which I think most people know about, what can people expect from you in your first weeks and months of office? What will be your priorities, and how fast will you ring the changes?
Well, could I pick up the last part first, Gary? We're not going to move quickly because I believe that what the people of Australia want from the incoming government is calmness, a sense of assuredness. The problems confronting us are deep, and I believe that if we're going to make the sensible decisions which are best going to meet the interests of this country in crisis, that we shouldn't move quickly. The first thing that I want to ensure is that Mr. Fraser and his colleagues have the opportunity of closing their files with dignity and without being rushed. They will have every opportunity to finish those tasks and to clear up, as I say, with dignity. I have already, on the assumption, and I know that the people would have expected me to act in this way, I have had already considerable discussions with many of my colleagues as to the sorts of things that we need to do to ensure a smooth transition and one which, I say, provides the opportunity of dignity and decency for Mr. Fraser and those around him. We will, as from tomorrow, or is it tomorrow? No, as from today, we will be meeting with the relevant permanent heads, the head of the Prime Minister's department, and meetings are already in place to ensure that, in a technical sense, we do those things that are necessary. And all I can say is that from this moment onwards, I and my colleagues will be working to ensure that we get the government into place in an efficient way to commence to do those range of things which are necessary, as I say, to bring the country together. Our theme in this campaign was not something confected for the purposes of the campaign. we are committed to national reconciliation for the purposes of recovery and reconstruction, to give hope where I believe in the past there has increasingly been despair.
Mr. Cook, Ian McMinn from Network 10. During the Whitlam government, sir, there was a great deal of obstruction in the Senate, and it would appear at this stage that Labor won't win the Senate. What type of attitude will you be approaching Don Chipp with, indeed, to try to get through bills that are necessary to bring about much of Labor's platform?
Well, there's not only Don Chipp, there's Brian Harradine. I think probably now he only gets one. There was at one stage of the count the possibility that he may have got two. I'll be talking with the Democrats and with Brian Harradine. I will explain to them that clearly we've been given a mandate. I will expect not that they drop their rights to discuss. Of course, that's what they're there for. But I believe we have been given a clear mandate, and the legislation which will go before the Senate will be clearly in line with that mandate. And I believe that they will see that what we propose is in the interest of our country. I do not expect problems in that area.
Mr. Hook, John Mangos from National 9 News.
Yes, John.
So given that we've had an election every 2 years for the past decade, will you legislate for fixed-term parliaments? And also given that you're 53 years old and you don't lose any future elections, how many of those terms do you expect to serve as Prime Minister?
Well, John, in respect of the first question, yes, we will be bringing legislation at a quite early stage, I hope, to try and rid Australia of this frequency of elections, which above all else have been destabilising for our community. We will be proposing that the Parliament gives the opportunity of deciding that there should be fixed 4-year parliaments, and that the only circumstances in which there could be an early termination of the normal duration of the Parliament would be where there was a real deadlock in which no government could be formed on the floor of the People's House, the House of Representatives, or there was a real deadlock and not a manufactured one. But we will be proposing that there be put within those circumstances a powerful disincentive to anyone to so abruptly terminate, because in those circumstances we would be proposing that any government which arose out of an election in those circumstances would only serve out the remainder of the term of the previous government.
Mr. Hawke, Robert Kinney from the 2UE network. Steele Hall said earlier this evening, while conceding that the Liberal Party was in trouble, that he thought given an extra week of campaigning the result could have been different. What's your reaction to that?
Well, my reaction to that is the obvious one. I didn't call the election. I didn't fix the time of the campaign. Mr. Fraser did that. And obviously he did it in terms which he thought would be propitious to his cause. I believe it was one of many miscalculations that he has made.
John Stanley from the Macquarie Radio Network. You said during the campaign you envisaged a role in the new national reconciliation for people from the other side of politics. Who in the now opposition would you see having something to contribute, and what role would they play?
Oh, I think there are many, very many of the of our parliamentary colleagues, and I use that term advisedly, in the Liberal and National Party who will still be in the Parliament, who have great capacity and integrity and a role to play. Now, obviously, they haven't got a role in government. But what I was saying to the people of Australia during the campaign, that I believe that one of the great problems that has been confronting this country is that the institution of Parliament has become somewhat degraded, in that members of Parliament on both sides haven't had the opportunity to participate fully in a way which allows an input from them, because once legislation, proposed legislation, has been decided in the party room, the debates to some extent in the Parliament itself have become a charade. Now, I'm expressing a personal view, which I think will be shared by a great majority of my colleagues, that it would make a great deal of sense to enlarge the committee system within the House of Representatives, so that there would be an opportunity for people on both sides to have a greater real participation within the Parliament. I think that would be good for them as members of Parliament, and to the extent that we can open up those processes to the public as well, I think the whole institution of parliamentary democracy will be enhanced. And I think that that's important, because it's dangerous for a democracy if the institution of Parliament becomes demeaned.
Capital 7, Mr. Hawke, you've indicated that there would be some short transition before you take over government. When would you anticipate seeing the Governor-General to be sworn in as Prime Minister? Will you wait till full caucus meets? And remembering the 1975 election and the circumstances in which that was called, will you be seeking an assurance from the Governor-General that he will act only on the advice of his ministers from a majority in the House of Representatives?
Well, let me go back to the first part of your question. As to when the Governor-General commissions me, that is a matter, I would think, of joint discussion. I'm not seeking to impose my view upon the Governor-General. I think that would be improper. I would think that that would happen early in this coming week, and I would expect that we would be able to have a caucus meeting on Thursday of this coming week, and at that meeting, of course, the caucus would elect those members of the caucus who would be become members of the ministry. In respect of the latter point, part of your question, I have no reason to believe that this Governor-General has in these circumstances acted otherwise than properly. I would not presume to tell him how to act. I believe he knows what are the proper means of conducting relationships between himself and the Prime Minister.
Well, that's Mr. Bob Hawke in our Canberra studios. And obviously Mr. Hawke is making it very clear that he considers himself now to be the new Prime Minister of Australia, leading a Labor Party into the next Australian government. Well, it's certainly been an interesting night here in the National Tally Room in Canberra. And in fact, that brings us very close to the end of our national broadcast here in Canberra. It may well be that states around Australia will continue broadcasting as results come in. But perhaps before we leave the national tally room in Canberra, Dr. Victor Prescott, could you perhaps summarise for us the developments that have seen what seems to be certainly a change of government this evening?
Well, the situation is that Labor did extremely well in the four large states. New South Wales, it appears to have won five seats: Phillip, Eden Monaro, MacArthur, Barton and Calair. In Victoria, they've had the most successful campaign. They appear to have won Diamond Valley, Casey, Flinders, Bendigo, Deakin and Chisholm. In Queensland, they appear to have won Petrie, Herbert. They're very strong in Fadden, and they appear to have won Bowman. Leichhardt and Morton are very close and could go either way at the present time. Kingston in South Australia has gone to the Labour Party. The Northern Territory is in doubt for Grant Tambling of the Coalition. And in Western Australia, the seats where the Labour Party is leading, although I'm sure that the Liberals will not yet concede them, are Stirling, Tangy, Canning, Perth and Moore. If Labour won all those seats, it would have a majority of 27 in the new Parliament. It seems quite likely that some of them, at least, will stay with the coalition, and therefore we can expect that the majority of the Labour Party will be something, some odd number, less than 27, but probably more than 19. The figures overall, in terms of primary votes, show that the Labour Party has consistently won about 5% more of the primary votes in New South Wales, Victoria, Queensland, South Australia. In Western Australia, the early figures reflect a gain to the Labour Party of 11%. Tasmania is the only black spot as far as the Labour Party is concerned. There is a deficit there of 5%. And Labour appears to have done reasonably well in the rural areas, and in fact, it does appear to have won some rural seats. Richard.
Well, thank you very much indeed, Victor. As I said, it's been a very interesting night in the national tally room. But now, since we haven't been back to the States since about 10 o'clock Eastern Summer Time this evening, it's over to the States.
Well, and this time it's good morning from Melbourne. We'll be taking a look through the entire Victorian board. But first, Graham, what's the breakup of the state of the parties for the Victorian seats?
Well, the situation in Victoria is that there's 33 House of Representatives seats. As a result of tonight's proceedings, it now seems almost certain that the Labor Party has gained 6 to hold 23 of those 33 seats. The Liberal Party would lose 6 to hold only 7. In the metropolitan area, they would hold four seats: Bruce, Balaclava, Higgins and Kooyong. In the country area, Corangamite, Indi and Wannon. And the National Party would retain their three seats, assuming they hold Gippsland, which seemed to be the trend on the figures that we had seen at the last look. That would give them their three seats.
All right, well, let's start that call of the board now, and Balaclava's the first one.
Yes, well, Balaclava, as I just mentioned, is one of the few metropolitan seats the Liberal Party will hold. The minister for former minister, as it would be, for Industry and Commerce, Mr McPhee, holding that seat, although a swing of 3.7% on a two-party preferred basis to the ALP.
Right, Ballarat is next.
In Ballarat, the sitting member there is Mr John Mildren, and he will hold that seat.
And as has plagued us throughout this coverage, we seem to have lost the computer line from Canberra. But we have got some figures that are fairly recent that we will be able to bring up for you. So there's some from, and in fact for Ballarat it's final, so that's fine anyway.
Yes, well that's Mr Mildren holding the seat. John Ronan, the Liberal Party candidate there, ran with the campaign slogan, "Stop Groaning, Vote Ronan," but that wasn't good enough for him, and Mr Mildren will continue as the sitting member.
It was Mr Ronan, actually, who had rather an interesting description of his occupation, wasn't it? He was a potato and mixed farmer.
Yes, I did meet him up there, and he was fairly active in the area.
All right, Batman now.
Yes, Brian Howe, the sitting member in Batman, has held the seat and increased his majority.
And safely in the seat. Bendigo.
Bendigo, one of the interesting seats in the state figures. The government whip, Mr John Boucher, has lost that seat, and the new member will be Mr John Brumby. He's a union official with the Victorian Teachers Union, 29 years old.
Yes, no, there's the final figures for Bendigo now.
Yes.
The next seat is Bruce.
Yes, the Speaker in the House of Representatives since 1976, Billy Snedden, holding the seat, but a swing against him there, but he will hold the seat.
Those are final figures. And now our computer line is back, so we'll move on to the seat of Burke.
Yes, Andrew Theophanous took this seat in 1980 when he took over from Mr Keith Johnson after winning pre-selection, and he has also increased his majority by a he's increased his majority by 8% on a two-party preferred basis.
And that's a final figure for the night. Now on to Casey.
Casey, one of the seats that has gone to the Labor Party, Peter Falconer, who was elected in 1975 when he beat Race Matthews, now a state minister, has lost that seat to Peter Steedman. He's a 40-year-old research officer, president of the Diamond Valley branch of the ALP and a former advisor to Senator John Button.
And on to Chisholm.
Chisholm, a seat which has again gone to the Labor Party, Graham Harris, has lost that seat to Helen Mayer from the ALP.
Now to Tony Street's seat of Corangamite.
Tony Street will hold that seat fairly safe in the country there.
All right, the next is Corio.
Gordon Scholes, the opposition spokesman for defence in the ACT, will hold that seat. He's increased his margin by 3.5%.
Again, of course, these are final figures for the night. Not necessarily completely final figures, of course, because all the vote hasn't been counted. From Corio, we move on to the seat of Deakin.
Deakin, Mr John Saunderson, will take over this seat for the ALP. He's an industrial officer with the Australian Telecommunications Employees Association. He's beaten Alan Jarman.
Diamond Valley,
it would appear the Democrats' preferences. They're giving the seat to the Labor candidate, Peter Staples, over the Minister for Communications, Mr Brown.
Flinders, that was the unpredictable one.
Yes, Peter Reith, who never took a seat in Parliament, has lost the seat to Robert Chenoweth, who stood. He replaced Rogan Ward, who lost the by-election for the Labor Party up there. He didn't win it. And he asked Robert Chenoweth to stand, and he's done the job.
He doesn't even get a pension. Now on to Gellibrand.
Yes, Ralph Willis, one of Labor's safest seats in the state. He had a margin of 21%, and he's increased it even further with a 5.5% swing on a two-party preferred basis.
Gippsland is next. That's the seat of the Peter Nixon, the former minister.
Yes, Primary Industry Minister Peter Nixon has left that seat, but his successor will be a 27-year-old solicitor, Peter McGoran, who seems likely to take that seat with the assistance of the Liberal Party preferences.
Now moving on to Henty, which was regarded as a marginal Labor seat.
Yes, Joan Child in Henty has picked up a swing of 5.1% to increase her majority, making that a much safer Labor seat.
Higgins, a safe Liberal seat.
Yes, Roger Shipton had a margin of 10%. He has seen a swing of about 4% on a two-party preferred basis to the ALP, but will hold that seat without trouble.
Now on to Holt.
And Holt, Michael Duffy, in the Dandenong area, that seat covers. He took the seat in 1980 from the Liberals and has swung it further to Labor with a 6% swing on a two-party preferred basis.
To Hotham.
Yes, Lewis Kent, the former station master for the ALP, and he has also increased the party's majority by that 6%.
Indi.
Liberals have only seen a small swing there to the Labor Party, and Mr. Ewan Cameron will hold the seat.
And I'm sorry we're going to have to leave it there, because we're going back to the National Tally Room in Canberra.
Looking very pleased, obviously, with tonight's results. Of course, as you would expect, many people are trying to talk to him all at once, and it's not easy. Mr. Hawke is now making his way, as you can see, to the front area of the tally room here in Canberra, close to the tally board there. We're hoping that he may have a few words to say. And of course, like everybody else, we would like to be able to talk with him. You can just see Mr. Hawke's hair in the midst of all the other heads that are down there. So many cameras, microphones, members of the press, radio and television stations, all trying to talk with him at once. He's being protected by at least one or two policemen down there. As we mentioned earlier tonight, the whole tally room is packed with people who've been most interested all through the evening in the progress in tonight's election results. Mr. Hawke at the moment seems to have come to not exactly a standstill, but certainly his progress past the tally board there has been fairly slow as he's forcing his way past the crowd here. We're not quite sure exactly where he's heading at this stage, because of course everybody wants to talk with him. Certainly we do. He seems to be doing virtually a circle of the tally room at this stage. He's gone right across the tally board. You can follow his progress in a sense by following the concentration of camera flashes and the number of microphones that are poked in the air, hopefully trying to get either atmospheric noise of how the crowd is behaving here or any comments that Mr. Hawke might like to make. It's probably worth mentioning that here in the tally room there are journalists from at least 10 countries around the world, and it's not only Australian journalists, of course, who would like the opportunity to speak with Mr. Hawke. So at the moment, we've just been trying to follow Mr. Hawke. It looks as though he's actually leaving the tally room now. In fact, he's coming around just behind the ABC desk here. There's an extraordinary crush of cameramen and sound people rushing with cables and lights and microphones. He's actually moving up to one of the scaffold situations just near us. And as you can hear, the crowd behind are very enthusiastically showing their approval for Mr. Hawke. In fact, I doubt very much that you can hear me very clearly if you're listening at home, because I can hardly hear myself speak. Mr. Hawke is now standing up on a scaffold, looking down at the crowd, which is down below here at the tally room in Canberra, waving, looking very pleased and happy, understandably, with the degree of enthusiasm, the enthusiastic applause which he's receiving from the crowd below. He's now moving back to the back of the scaffold. It's not quite clear exactly what he's going to do next. I think he's going to be tied up for a short time. We'll be talking with him as soon as we can. He has mentioned that he'll be probably joining us here on the panel in the tally room at some stage during the evening. So as soon as that becomes a possibility, that's exactly what we'll be doing. He should be sitting here in front of our ABC cameras and speaking with you. In fact, he'll be speaking with Barry Cassidy here. Barry, you noticed in that press conference which Mr. Hawke gave in the ABC studios just a short time ago that his performance, in your eyes, having followed him on the campaign trail for so long, was not quite what you expected.
I found it a remarkable performance, and I found the most interesting aspect of it was that Mr. Hawke chose to hold that news conference before coming here and meeting the crowds and taking in the elation and the emotion. What he chose to do was to go to the sanity, if you like, of a television studio, the ABC studios here in Canberra, to make what really amounted to an address to the nation. It was a dignified Bob Hawke. It was a cool and mellowed Bob Hawke, and that's the image he projected during the campaign. I suppose it's a contrast with how Mr. Whitlam accepted victory in 1972 amid great scenes of emotion and excitement in his electorate. Plainly, it's all part of Mr. Hawke's strategy. He sees his task as going well beyond this night in 1983, and I'm sure the manner in which he chose to present himself after achieving victory tonight was significant.
Well, indeed. It's certainly an interesting situation here in the tally room now that Mr. Hawke has arrived. As you could see very clearly, and probably hear very clearly as well, there was a very strong response from the floor where all the people have been watching eagerly tonight as results have gone up on the tally room board, watching from whichever parties they're associated with. But there was certainly a very strong response when Mr. Hawke arrived with his wife Hazel in the tally room. He still seems to be tied up at the moment, but as soon as he becomes free, we'll be trying to talk with him here on the panel in the ABC coverage of the election here in the Canberra tally room. However, what we're going to do now is try and get some reactions from our guest panel. So we'll be crossing in just a moment to Peter Couchman, and we'll be finding out just what our panelists think of the latest developments. Over to you, Peter.
Yes, well, thank you, Richard. How do you feel at the moment, Steele Hall?
Well, I feel a bit demolished, of course. However, one must say the polls were right this time. They didn't diverge much from the result.
Indeed. Now, I'm wondering why Malcolm Fraser hasn't made any statement at all now.
I can't say. I have no contact with that in Melbourne and that. But I would have thought by now that one would concede.
I suppose there'll be a great deal of time spent on the post-mortems now, as far as the Liberal Party's
concerned.
Yeah. Catherine West made an interesting point the other day. She said that you really lost this election in 1980, but nobody realised it at the time. Would you?
I think that's very true, Peter, because we went into the 1980 election about 2% ahead of Labor, and we went down 0.7% from the figure we held when we went into the result. This time, we went in about 6% below Labor. And we didn't just have to hold the fort, we had to make up about 6%. I think that was an impossible task.
So you really went into this election feeling a bit pessimistic?
I certainly did, yeah.
What happens to Malcolm Fraser now?
I don't know, you'll have to ask Mr. Fraser.
It's going to rest, of course, with people like yourself.
Oh, it'll rest with... Well, it'd probably rest firstly with him. He obviously will make up his mind as what he wants to do, and it's not for me to presume.
Well, it will be in a way. I mean, it won't be up to him to make up his mind. I mean, you go into the party room, surely there'll be a spill of positions.
Well, Peter, we're not there yet, so we'll have to wait and see what happens beforehand. You're quite right, there is a spill of positions, of course, after every election. And I can't presume to say what it would mean.
Surely Mr. Fraser will carry at least some of the odium for the loss in this campaign, because it was very much a personal campaign. It was Malcolm Fraser running this campaign alone.
Well, if you're involved in a presidential-style election, obviously the loser is involved deeply with the reasons that caused that loss, and that can't be avoided because of the very nature of the thing.
Were you disturbed by his style during the campaign?
I wouldn't like to say I was disturbed by it. There are things I would have done differently, I suppose, but...
What things precisely?
Quite frankly, Peter, referring again to that point that you made about Catherine West, that we went in, we lost in 1980, I agree with that. And I think all the rest is a sort of detail. We were trying to avoid that basic concept that the election wasn't available to us in those circumstances, given the rise in unemployment and the pressure on Australia, which
the sort of pressures which has thrown state governments out of office in Australia and governments out of office nationally, internationally, across the world.
Yes, the extraordinary thing is the Liberal machine right through until the final hour seemed to have some abiding faith in Malcolm Fraser's impeccable political judgment and his timing. But would you agree that his timing was wrong this time?
Well, again, he was in possession of all the facts, and of course I wasn't as a backbencher. I wouldn't have gone now, but that's again another matter. I suppose other members of the party would have, and I know some who would have liked to have gone the full term. I think the public would have liked to have gone the full term, and we were in some trouble going early and then giving support basically to a referendum to establish fixed term parliaments, and that didn't add up, along with a number of factors which gave us a bad base in calling the election.
Do you think his style, Malcolm Fraser's style in this campaign, was a significant factor at all?
I don't think it was any different than it's ever been.
I ask that because there was a noticeable contrast between Malcolm Fraser's style and the style that was adopted, for instance, by Andrew Peacock, John Howard and Ian Fee.
I suppose they're being themselves. I think there's one big consideration that in 1975 and in 1977, the Liberal Party in Australia fought against a devalued Prime Minister, Mr. Whitlam. He was devalued already by the time he went to the 1975 election, by those events and by events occurring during his government. And Mr. Hayden really didn't set himself up as an extremely popular leader for 1980, so I guess that this is the first time the Liberal Party has run against a charismatic leader such as Mr. Hawke is.
Right. Colin Mason, why do you think the government lost? Do you agree that governments lose and oppositions don't win?
I think particularly so in this election. It is very clear that the government lost. I think it was largely the campaign. The campaign was so negative, or it seemed to me so negative. In times of rising unemployment and great difficulties to industry, I think simply to say, go along with us, things are going to get better sometime, is not good enough. And although, of course, Malcolm Fraser changed that tune towards the end, I think the people didn't really get that feeling. I think they got the feeling of a clear choice between hope, and that's what Bob Hawke offered them, although I must say it's been very unspecific hope and not many details, but at least hope, and just gloomy going along with the same thing. And I really think that's what's caused...
Do you think the Fraser style was a factor in the campaign, in the result?
Yes, I think it was. I think there again that Bob Hawke is seen, rightly or wrongly, as a sort of popular hero in this country. He gets across to the average person, and they like him. And I don't think they, although they may respect Mr. Fraser, I don't think they like him. And I think that has also been a very big factor in the situation in the House of Representatives.
Well, Steele Hall's being very cagey because undoubtedly now he's going to be involved in what happens next in one way or another. What do you think happens to Malcolm Fraser now? Will it be his own decision, his future, do you think?
I think it probably will be. I mean, I hate to speak for another man, but I think in his position he may well feel that he doesn't want to continue as leader of the opposition. I don't know. I would think perhaps the Prime Minister, as long serving as he, that he might well, being the man he is, feel that he doesn't want to go on as leader of the opposition.
Well, Barry Cassidy's been making the point right through the campaign that it's been said that if he loses tonight, the first by-election will be for the seat of Wannon in Victoria, that he won't stay around. Just before we finish, I've not come to you, Susan, because I expect you to say the obvious, but I mean, why do you think you won?
Well, I think that the electorate was really disaffected with the Fraser government. They'd had 7 years, things had gone from bad to worse, and obviously we won a lot of votes over to our side that normally go towards the Conservative parties. I think that our campaign was very good. It's certainly the best of the four federal campaigns I've been involved in. We were able to develop a theme which was appropriate to the time. We were able to stick to the theme despite the various attempts of people to deflect us from it. And of course, we had leading us a man who is trusted by the community, who does inspire hope. And I think that Australians basically wanted a change anyway. And the combination of Bob's leadership and the harmony, I must say, unusual harmony that prevailed throughout the Labor Party and the Labor movement generally, meant that we were an acceptable alternative. Well, more than acceptable, because we've had a very handsome victory.
Well, you're undoubtedly very tired now, but what were your feelings tonight when you saw all that happening?
Well, my main feeling was one of relief.
we've worked so hard for so long and so many people were hanging on us winning and being able to do something for the country, that my first feeling was relief rather than excitement.
Well, it was very dicey at one stage there in the evening.
Yes, we've had a lot of knockbacks in the past and we weren't going to rush in quickly and claim victory until it was very clear, but it is now very clear that we've had a very, very handsome mandate.
Bob Hawke's coming down from the platform. We'll cross back to Richard. I think he'll be joining us on the main panel.
Thank you very much, Peter. Well, all the tumultuous applause which you heard just then, or which you can still hear, is because just for a moment Bob Hawke became visible up in the scaffolding on a higher level in the tally room here. We can just see him from where we're sitting. He has agreed at some stage to come and talk with us here on the panel, and we're anticipating his arrival at some stage. Of course, as soon as that is possible, then we'll be bringing Bob Hawke to you on our panel here in the tally room. It's probably worth mentioning that here in the tally room in Canberra, the time is now something like 20 to 1, yet the tally room is still packed with the same number of people that it was earlier and in the middle of the evening. The time in the morning doesn't seem to have deterred them at all. I don't know whether you can actually see the number of people who are crammed into the space behind me here. The tally room is full of people, all of whom are still very much reacting to the results of the night. But as soon as Mr. Bob Hawke becomes available, then we'll be talking with him. We've been on air now, as you may know, here in Canberra and in South Australia, Victoria, New South Wales, and so on, for about 4 hours or more now. So it's been a very long and fascinating night. In fact, some of the results tonight have been interesting. Of course, now it is a little bit later in the night. We can perhaps have a bit of a look briefly at some of the developments in the Senate. As Dennis Grant mentioned earlier, it's difficult to have any very firm Senate results until sometimes even a week after the actual election date. But Dennis, have you got anything worthwhile we can mention about the Senate at the moment?
Well, what I can
above
say
the cheering,
if I can keep it above the cheering, is that, look, these figures are coming in now and they are a shade confused. But look, if I just bounce through the quotas between Senate seats, looks like this. In New South Wales, the ALP are picking up at least 5. The National Party, at least 4. The Democrats haven't yet scored 1, but they're not far off it. In Victoria, ALP has got at least 5, National Party at least 4, the Democrats have got 1 in Victoria so far. That's something like 56% of the Senate vote counted. In Queensland, the ALP have got at least 4 seats, 4 quotas, that's to say. The Liberal Party's 1 and they're on their way to a 2nd. The National Party 3 in Queensland. And Senator Bonner, interestingly enough, has got 0.7 of the quota, and that's 25% of the vote counted in Queensland. Could change somewhat there. South Australia, the ALP has 5 quotas, the Liberal Party 4 quotas, the Democrats 1 and maybe a 3rd, and that's with 82% of the Senate vote counted in South Australia. West Australia, really, it's only something like 1% of the vote there, and it's changing somewhat. In Tasmania, the ALP have got at least 3 quotas. The Liberal Party have got 4. Democrats, about 3/4 of a quota at the moment. Senator Harradine looked as if he was going to get up his running mate earlier in the night, and at the moment he's got 1.99 of a quota. So he's just a hair's breadth away from 2. But I have to emphasise that with 78% of that Senate vote in Tasmania counted, it looks as if it's declining somewhat. Interesting result here in the ACT, and this is with something like 55% of the Senate votes counted here in the ACT. The ALP has, Senator Ryan was smiling earlier on, has 1.67, so they're well on the way to a 2nd. The Liberal Party have yet to achieve, and this is with 55% of the vote, a full quota in the ACT. ACT has gone very much to Labor tonight. In the Northern Territory, again, something only of the order of 2% of the vote in there, but the quotas have fallen to the Labor Party, to the Liberal Party, and there's a bit of a mishmash with the Democrats there. So, Richard, what we can say is that there is the usual degree of uncertainty attached to Senate figures tonight. The interesting thing, I think, so far has been the performance of Senator Harradine. I said earlier in the night that he was the major worry for the Labor Party in that state. Indeed, he has been, and he must have worried those Labor numbers men earlier in the night.
That's about the situation with the Senate, but again, we won't really know, we won't really have concrete figures until roughly about halfway through next week, Richard.
Well, thanks very much, Dennis.
Dennis Grant competing very bravely there with some very loud applause from the background. The thing is that every time Mr. Hawke becomes visible here in the tally room, the people who are behind us, who are who have been in the tally room for most of this evening, break into very loud applause. So we hope you could hear most of what Dennis had to say. And in fact, we can't really hear ourselves speak when the applause really gets into full swing because it is just so loud. We're going to be crossing now to Peter Couchman and our guest panel. Peter is talking with Colin Mason, Deputy Leader of the Australian Democrats.
Yes, thank you, Richard. It occurs to me, actually, you know, this is the first election I can recall in which Bob Hawke hasn't been sitting on one of these panels. He's making up for it now. I think he hasn't been off television ever since he came into the tally room. What about the composition of the Senate now? Because this is the critical factor. It looks most unlikely that Labor will get their majority in the Senate. And you've been polling pretty well. You've been talking to your scrutineers. What figures have you got for the likely composition of the new Senate?
We think that it will probably be 29 ALP, 27 Liberal National Party. We don't know about Western Australia, but we think our man there on the figures from the lower house will look pretty good. Could be six Democrats and Senator Harradine too. This would mean, however, that...
So you're giving Senator Harradine a running mate with him, are you?
Yes, but it's academic. That's Jones' running mate. It's purely academic. If on those figures I've given you, the Democrats voting with the Liberal National Party would have the balance to outvote the Labor Party if, in the event, that was necessary.
So this puts you back into the role that you ask people to give you, the role
yes,
of the minder.
I would say that is what is happening, that the Democrats have been put back in the role of the minders.
Didn't pick up the seats you'd have liked to have won in the Senate. Are you disappointed with that result?
I'm not disappointed with it. It should give us one senator from every state. We would have liked to have done better. Everybody would have liked to have done better. But there again, in the atmosphere and climate of this great swing, I think we've done pretty well.
Yes, indeed. You seem to find yourself in accord with the Labor Party on most of the important issues. I mean, what sort of cooperation would you expect in the new Senate?
Well, we've made it quite clear that whatever government was elected, we would allow it to pursue its mandate, which is what we've done with the Liberal government. But where it breaks an election promise for which there is not a clear justification, or where it brings forward extremist or confrontative legislation, we will not allow that to pass. And that will be the case with the Labor government, just as it was with the Liberal National Party government.
Well, for instance, Bob Hawke has said tonight that one of the first things he wants to do is to introduce legislation for a fixed-term parliament. Would you support that sort of initiative?
Yes, we would support that because we've already supported that and voted for the Evans Bill in the Senate. That is something we would vote for. But I'm not prepared to speculate on other issues at this stage.
Well, Senator Ryan, what sort of an assessment do you make of the working relationship in the new Senate?
Well, I'm hopeful that we'll have a good working relationship with the Democrats. We did have...
You're going to need them, aren't you?
Well, that's as it appears now, and I think that it will remain that way, that we'll, whatever happens, we won't ourselves have a majority. So we will have to work with the Democrats. Speaking on the kinds of areas I've been involved in, Aboriginal land rights, human rights kinds of legislation...
We will be crossing back to the National Tally Room in Canberra if Mr. Hawke arrives at our panel for an interview, or if Mr. Fraser appears at the Southern Cross, we'll be going there. In the meantime, we'll continue with that call of the Victorian Board that we got just halfway through a little earlier this morning. And let's go straight into the seat of Isaacs, Graham.
Yes, this was one of Labor's more marginal seats in Victoria. David Charles was the sitting member, and he has increased his majority on a two-party preferred basis by nearly 7% to make that a fairly safe seat at the moment for the Labor Party.
Right, now to Kooyong.
Yes, Mr. Peacock, who will have an interesting time ahead of him, has held that seat, a swing, interestingly, there of only 2.7% against Mr. Peacock on a two-party preferred basis. We can move on now to the seat of Lawler. This is one of Labor's safest seats in Victoria. Mr. Barry Jones, the former state member who went up to the National Parliament in 1977, has increased his majority only marginally there, but there wasn't much room for increase.
Yeah, right, on to La Trobe.
And La Trobe. Peter Milton, the sitting Labor member there, had a margin of 2.3% when he went to the polls today, and he's increased that on a two-party preferred basis by 8.2%.
Right, McMillan, which at the start of the poll was regarded as a marginal Labor seat.
Yes, it was one of Labor's very marginal seats in Victoria. I think, in fact, the second most marginal in the state, apart from Ballarat. And the final figures show a swing of 1.4% on a two-party preferred basis to the sitting Labor member, Mr. Barry Cunningham.
Right, and now to Mallee, a country seat.
Yes, Peter Fisher will hold that seat without any difficulty.
All right, Maribyrnong.
Maribyrnong, where Mr. Moss Cass has retired. We've got the new Labor member, Alan Griffiths. He's an industrial officer, and he has increased the party's vote there by about 4.5%.
All right, Melbourne is next.
Yes, that's where Gerry Hand has taken over the seat from Ted Innes. And again, it was a very safe Labor seat before tonight and has an increase in its vote there of about 4.5%.
Yeah, I should point out that these figures are all being shown as final figures. And of course, they're just the final figures for tonight. It doesn't mean that all the votes have necessarily been counted. All right, the next one is Melbourne Ports.
Melbourne Ports, Mr. Clyde Holding's seat. He's increased his margin there by about 1%. The Australian Democrat sitting there was the first Victorian president of the party, John Sutcliffe.
Right, from Melbourne Ports to the seat of Murray.
Yes, a safe National Party seat held by Bruce Lloyd, and he's had no trouble holding that seat.
Right, from Murray to Scullin.
Yes, another very safe Labor Party seat in Victoria. Dr. Harry Jenkins holding that and increasing his vote on a two-party preferred basis by about 2.5% with 87% of the votes counted.
Right, from Scullin now to Wannon, the seat held by Mr. Malcolm Fraser.
Yes, Mr. Fraser has seen a swing away from him of less than 1% on primary votes. The overall vote of the ALP on a two-party preferred basis, though, has gone up about 2%, but it's still a safe seat for Mr. Fraser.
And now, finally, Wills, held by Mr. Bob Hawke, who will be the next Prime Minister of Australia.
Yes, and Mr. Hawke wouldn't be disappointed with the result out there. He had a margin of 19%, which he collected when he stood for the seat for the first time in 1980. He's increased that on a two-party preferred basis by about 4.5%. That takes us through the board, Ralph.
Indeed. Well, we did finally get through the board, even with a lot of interruptions, both from Canberra and from the Canberra computer giving us all sorts of problems. Can we just have a quick look again? We did start out in the first part of this final segment at the breakdown, the figures breakdown of the Victorian seats that you had, Graham.
Yes. Overall in Victoria, we've got 33 seats in the state from the House of Representatives. The situation appears to be that of the 33 Victorian House of Representatives seats, 23 will now be held by the Labor Party, 6 of those coming from the Liberals, who will have 7, and the National Party will retain their 3 seats.
Right, thanks, Graham. And now we're returning to the National Tally Room in Canberra and Richard Moorcroft.
We've got the seat of Tangney. In order of difficulty, probably number 5 on the West Australian seats for the Labor Party to win. But the swings that the Labor Party has gained in Western Australia are comparable with that gained during the West Australian state election. The swing with 58.2% of the vote counted in Tangney, the swing to the Labor Party in two-party preferred is 8.7%. Now, with that sort of swing, and I think given the size of the vote counted, there seems little doubt that, that Tangney has a new member.
The seat of Canning in Western Australia, held in the last parliament by Harold Bungy. Farmer, east and south of Perth. They've counted 28% of the vote, and already Mrs. Wendy Payton has a lead of 3,000 votes and will be very difficult to catch.
Victor, you're probably having a bit of trouble being heard at the moment. The reason for the loud noise is that once again Mr. Hawke has started passing through the crowd, and it looks as though he may well be on his way now to visit us here at the ABC desk in the tally room. He's just pausing to talk with some members of the crowd who've been here so long in the tally room this evening in Canberra. We're hoping that he might be heading in our direction, but at the moment his back seems to be to us. If we can persuade him to head in this direction, then we certainly will. We do understand that he'll be happy to join us at some stage this evening.
And as I mentioned earlier, we also hope to hear from the Prime Minister, Mr. Fraser. During the evening, we have our outside broadcast unit stationed at the Southern Cross Hotel in Melbourne, where Mr. Fraser is. Now, though, we can see Mr. Hawke wending his way, surrounded by various people. He's coming around now. We might, in fact, have to do a bit of seat shuffling. So if you'll excuse me, Barry Cassidy has a few words to say while I...
Mr. Hawke, mate, I'll just put a microphone on you before we get started.
Hello.
Hello, Mr. Hawke, Member of Parliament for 2 years and 4 months, Leader of the Parliamentary Labour Party for just 4 weeks. Is this a considerable ego boost to Bob Hawke, or is it a sobering experience?
Oh, it's more a sobering experience. I think the evidence has been available to those who followed me in this campaign and to the people of Australia that I think I've behaved sensibly. I hope I have. I've been conscious of the, well, enormous responsibility that's been placed upon me, and that's the sense that I have, that I know now that it's not just the responsibility that the party has placed upon me, but the people of Australia. And that's what I'm concerned about.
It appears that you'll end up with a majority somewhere between 19 and 29 seats. It does give you some room to play with, doesn't it?
Well, it's certainly a comfortable majority, and I believe, as I've been saying on other programs, Barry, that that will mean that the Senate will accept the fact that we do have a clear mandate, and I don't expect any problems there. But I do want to make a point that I have elsewhere, that I'm not now saying, well, look, to the opposition, we've got the numbers. Now, you just squirm over there. I believe that there are men and women of integrity and capacities in the opposition, and I hope that we'll be able to change some of the procedures in the Parliament so that those people have a greater opportunity for making a contribution to the processes, because, as I've said for a long time, I think one of the problems in our democracy is that the actual parliamentary processes have become somewhat demeaned. The people have some, not contempt is the word, but some scepticism about the Parliament. I think it's in everyone's interest, both the parties, both sides of politics and of the society, that we try and make it a more meaningful institution.
Can we attempt to draw a pen portrait of what a Hawke Labor government might be like? Will it be a Whitlam-esque style of government, a government in a hurry, if you like, or will it be perhaps one emulating Mr. Rann, a more moderate sort of Labor government?
Well, it's going to be a cautious government. It's certainly not going to be one which is going to be rushing into a whole range of decisions. I think, in the first place, as I've said, I won't be breathing down the neck of Mr. Fraser and his ministers. They'll be given the opportunity to tidy up their affairs with dignity. We already have arrangements in train for a smooth transition that I've had discussions with my colleagues. So I think what the people want now is calmness. I think they want me and my colleagues to give effect to, as we will, to the processes of national reconciliation. And you don't do that by racing in with a whole range of decisions. We'll make the decisions in time that they need to be made, but we really are going to be starting the process of bringing the people of this great country together, and that's our overwhelming commitment, and we'll do everything that's necessary to give effect to that.
When will caucus meet?
Thursday.
And that's when the cabinet will decide it?
That's when the election of the ministry will take place, yes.
Right, I wonder, Mrs. Hawke, if I could just ask you one question. Do you go into your task as First Lady of this country now with some trepidation?
Not trepidation, but a very great sense of responsibility.
Is it something you're looking forward to?
I'm looking forward to the whole experience. I'm delighted that the Labor government will be governing Australia, and I feel very privileged to be a part of that.
Mr. Hawke, political analyst Dr. Victor Pressman, yep. I believe he has one question for you as well.
Congratulations, Mr. Hawke.
Thanks, Victor.
Now I ask you one question. It's an electoral question. I presume a redistribution will be necessary before the next election because
yes.
there is a difference
yes.
of 63,000 to 100,000. Do you have any plans for electoral reform along the lines of optional preferential voting to reduce the very high incidence of informal voting in New South Wales and Victorian Senate election today, and also reducing the amount of deviation between seats.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Hawke.
Thank you, Mr. Hawke.
Richard Moorcroft is now making his way back onto our stand.
Well, would you like to continue while I just put myself back on?
Well, perhaps, Victor, we could do a summary now of the
well,
night.
I think we ought to finish off those Western Australian seats, which appear to have been lost by the government, because while almost anything is an anticlimax after that, there are still people whose futures are in doubt, and whose futures look very bright, I suppose. The seat of Canning in Western Australia has been held by Harold Bungie since 1974. His opponent this time was Mrs. Wendy Fayton, and with 27% of the vote counted, she already has a lead of 3,000 votes and is going to be very difficult to defeat. In the seat of Perth, the seat of Perth is held by Mr. McLean. It's situated near the centre of the metropolitan area. Ross McLean, he was elected in 1975, an administrative assistant from the University of Western Australia. He's 38 years old, and with half the vote counted, he is trailing his sporting opponent, Rick Charlesworth, by 4,000 votes. It seems extraordinarily hard for Mr. McLean to pick up those votes, especially since in the last election the Liberal candidate led throughout. And finally, the seat of Moore in Western Australia. The seat of Moore held by John Hyde. They've now counted 74% of the vote, and the swing to Labour is 10%, nearly 11%. In the last election, and I'm sorry for repeating myself, but the Liberals led all the time, and that's what makes this result so remarkable. And so now, with Mr. Blanchard trailing by 10,000 votes, there can be no doubt that... Mr. Hyde trailing by 10,000 votes, there can be no doubt that Cecil Blanchard, a public servant who stood in 1980, will be the new member for Moore. So that then is the position as we see it. 20 seats appear certain for the Labour Party, 5 are still in doubt. Northern Territory, Leichhardt, Diamond Valley, Riverina, that seems to be, and Morton. The only National Party casualty so far seems to be definitely Calair. The other National Party possible losses, of course, would be Leichhardt and the Northern Territory. But these are notoriously difficult to predict, and we'd have to wait, I think, until next week to know what the answer is there.
What is the situation in Riverina?
Well, we can have a look at Riverina. It's very close, and the late votes are going to be decisive. They have, you'll see, posted final figures now with 80% counted. You will see that the Labour Party candidate is 700 votes ahead, and there are 1,100 Democrat preferences to be distributed. So with still probably 15 or 16% of the vote to be counted, postal votes and late votes, then I would not wish to bet a fortune on the outcome of that election. But that could be the second National Party loss. Calair seems to be the devil.
I'm afraid I'll have to interrupt, Victor, because we're crossing now to Melbourne, where the Prime Minister, Mr. Fraser, has just made an appearance. As you can see, he's not looking a happy man, perhaps. Well, certainly, understandably, after the results of this evening's election. We understand that Mr. Fraser could be making a statement to people who are waiting in the Southern Cross Hotel in Melbourne. But we also understand that he won't be answering any questions. Mr. Fraser and his wife Tammy are now making an appearance, and we're standing by
to hear whatever Mr. Fraser has to say.
Ladies and gentlemen, I have a question.
Drop down, please, fellas.